If you don't know who I am, good. And I'm Paul Decker is my name. That's what my parents named me. And so I've kind of stayed with it ever since. And I'm the campus minister, I'm one of the campus ministers over at the University of Buffalo. So I'm just down the road the other way. And I just really want spring to happen, so I wore shorts today. People say, why do you have shorts on? Because I want spring. You know, when you get this old, you start getting desperate. You do go to desperate measures. So I figured I've been praying for you know, spring to happen, and it hasn't been working, so now I'm praying for winter to happen. I thought I'd use some reverse psychology on God and see how it worked.
You're saying
he's coming to teach us? Really? He's got bad theology. Okay, so that's a... Yeah, I have to admit that. Okay, so you're going to have up in front of you an old PowerPoint because my computer kind of froze up while I was trying to get it. I actually now have the right copy in front of me, but you got the old one. I mean, that's only 2015. I've taught this before, in case you...
What?
Yeah, really. So, I was asked to come with this topic, so that's just so you know. So, saying, what, don't you have any new material? No, I just keep doing the same thing over and over again. So, I used to, part of my story actually is that I was a pastor in churches for 30 years. I was in 4 different churches. And I started off out near the Albany area in the Mohawk Valley as a youth pastor. And then the Lord, after 6 years there, I moved down to the New York City area, just in northern New Jersey, just as part of the concrete extension of New York City. And then after that, I became a senior pastor and moved down to a church down in the Philadelphia area. And I have to tell you that, you know, I'm thinking Albany, New York, Philadelphia. I thought, wow, the next church I get to go to? Virginia! I was just moving down the map. Man, I was getting warmer and warmer. It didn't work out that way. I got sent to Buffalo.
Oh. I mean,
the only thing worse would have been Rochester. I mean, really, I was like, oh, sorry. Did I say that out loud? Or Syracuse, but anyways, like, I thought I'd throw it in there because I saw your Syracuse shirt. So I was like, I'm equal to everybody. Make fun of everybody. You're picking that
first
up.
Row.
Yeah, first row. Yeah, you're picking this up. You know, it's like he's going. You hardly know me. It's like I'm picking on him already. See. So, anyways, but actually, I did grow up in Western New York. Actually, most of my relatives were in the Rochester area, and so no one. But when I moved to Buffalo, no one had to trick me into becoming a Buffalo Bills fan or anything like that. You know, I was already there, and so. And so I was a senior pastor at a church called Randall Baptist Church in Williamsville on Main Street, and so I was there for 12 years. And but what happened while I was there, because of a lot of stress, there's actually I always tell you, pray for your pastor, that your pastor faces a lot more stress than you think he does, and actually it's a tremendous amount of stress. Your pastor probably hates Monday mornings because all the Monday morning quarterbacks come out and tell you what was wrong the day before. And it's really not a lot of fun, I'll tell you that. And there's a lot of great things about being a pastor. I don't want to get you all screwed up in your thinking, just partly screwed up. And it's really a tough job. It's very stressful, and you have a lot of bosses. And you kind of forget who the real boss is, which is God, you know. And so it's really easy to get that confused because you're hearing so many different voices. And after I'd been at Randall for about 7 or 8 years, my anxiety and stress was really building. I was facing a lot of opposition to some things I really thought needed to happen. I just felt like I kept running into walls all the time. And I did something during that time that was really unwise, and that is I just started to work harder. And I so badly thought that the church needed some change, and it did actually need the change. it eventually did happen. But I was working so hard to make that happen that I really kind of lost contact with this idea of rest. And I just kept working harder and harder, and I kept running into walls that seemed to be harder and harder. And eventually what started happening is I started having some anxiety was growing, stress was growing, and I started having some physical symptoms that were at best really kind of uncool. That is, I'd get really dizzy at really crazy times. I started having some confusion, having trouble making decisions, all things that really just weren't me at all. And I started going to, this was the year 2006 at this point in time, and I kept going to my doctor, who is also a good friend of mine and a Christian, and I kept saying, there is something wrong with me. And we were just taking blood tests after blood tests and trying to figure out what's wrong with me, and blood tests kept saying that I was normal. And I said, look at me, do I look normal to you? But let's not go there. Anyways, but the nevertheless, you know, he finally said, he said, Paul, I really know what's wrong with you. And I said, well, what is it? And he goes, you're really in a pretty severe and deep depression. And I'm going, no, I'm not. You know, it's like, the thing is that down deep, I actually knew he was right. But, you know, it's like, when you're a pastor, and you're a pastor of a pretty large church, and you've got a lot of people depending on you, and you've got a lot of staff that's working for you, this is not the, you know, you don't walk around saying, you know, when people ask you, how are you? You go, I'm depressed. You know, it's just like, it's just not, and you know, and this is no fun for the church either, by the way. How's your pastor? Oh, he's depressed. You know, like, you know. Can you imagine? I mean, it's just like, I really felt bad for them. To a point, they partly caused it. But anyways, you know, it wasn't all their fault. I mean, I shared a lot, but boy, I mean, they came to realize that they were really hurting me, and they finally got it. But one of the things I've learned, you can go to the next slide. Hopefully, it's the same slide I have. Yeah, good. Through the pain and stuff that I went through in terms of a depression, it's given me access to people, and even better access to people who have gone through the same thing. And so, you know, this, you know, you come to the end of something like this, and obviously, you know, I hope you look at me and say, well, he doesn't look depressed now. Good, that's a good thing. You know, it's like, but you know, this verse is really kind of pretty cool in a sense. It says, praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of compassion, and the God of all comfort, who comforts us in all our troubles so that we can comfort those in any trouble with the comfort we ourselves have received from God. You know, and since 2006, I found myself in a better position to help people who are struggling like I did. Not that I really wanted to go through that in order to be a comfort. I would rather, well, you know what I mean. So let me tell you a little bit about the kind of depression I'm talking about. You know, you're all students, and I think somewhere along the line, every student gets depressed. You know, it's just like, you know, it's like I see this at UB all the time. It's like, you know, and I work with a lot of graduate students now, and they're just banging their heads against the wall. There's so much work to do. You know, I'm working with med school students, and they're just like, they have no time, they have no life, and they're just like, ah, and you know, they just like, they're really feeling depressed. Give me this next slide. What do we got on here? So let me tell you what some depression is. It's more than a funk. And so, and usually what we're talking about on the school level, not all the time, sometimes it gets worse than this, but sometimes we just get in a funk because there's just too much work, too many papers, too many projects. And don't you hate those group projects? How many hate group projects? Yeah, because, see, all of you just raise your hand, you're the ones doing all the work, right? So that's all there is to it. You know, the ones that you didn't raise your hand, aha, we know who you are. You don't do any of the work, and you let them do the work. Okay, so anyways, that wasn't very nice of me, was it? I'm sorry. It kind of slipped out. I don't know how that happened. But anyways, but depression is, so a lot of times, but on the college level, a lot of times I'm dealing with people who are just, you got some minor stresses going on, you know, it's just you're feeling down, it lasts for a week or two, and we kind of get you picked up and ready and moving on, you know, and that's great. Believe me, that's a whole lot better than what I went through, okay? And sometimes it's more than that. I usually can see that in someone. I know if you're beyond something that's a little bit minor. And not that what you're feeling is really, it's yucky, by the way. I understand, not to say that it isn't important. But depression is really kind of a whole body illness because it affects everything. It takes down your mind. Your emotions go nuts. You are living constantly in extremes, and physically you just feel like you're in pain a lot. For me, by the way, the first physical ailment why I thought I needed to go to the doctor was that I was dizzy a lot. Now some of you are already, I know what you're thinking. You know, we didn't need a diagnosis of depression for you to be dizzy, but you know, just keep that to yourself. And so, but it was really interesting. I never picked up on the fact that the times that I most often was dizzy was in my office at the church. I'd go into the office, and it was like the room would start to spin. It was weird, you know. And it was just like, and I'd go home and I'd be kind of okay. And I'd go back the next day and go, what is wrong with this room? Or what is wrong with me? And, you know, the other things were obviously picking up on that, but so forth. A lot of hopelessness. When things really did set in, boy, did I feel hopeless. I felt like I'm a failure as a pastor. I'm a failure as a person. I'm a failure as a Christian. And there's just no improvement. It's just getting worse and worse and worse, and you know, you just don't see any way out of it. Even to the point where you start thinking that life isn't worth living. And I'll tell you, that was scary for me as a pastor, where I'm thinking, people depend on me in terms of their spiritual growth and faith, and I'm thinking life's not worth living. That was pretty crazy. I've always been very much an optimist. I really love life. I have a lot of joy in my life. I just enjoy things. And I got to a point that I wasn't enjoying anything. And it was such a huge difference to me. It was like, you know, I wasn't a melancholic personality getting depressed. I was someone who was just always upbeat, and now I had no beat. You know, I was just beat down, actually. And so it was just so different for me, and it was very humbling to my heart, and to be really not in control. Depression, by the way, really hard to admit, and if you've really suffered on any kind of level with it, often you'll say, you know, you say, I don't really want to tell people that I'm going through this, and yeah, I know, I get that. It's, you know, it's like, hey, how are you today? Depressed, you know. It's just like, you know, you just don't, you know, it's just not a fun thing to admit. And yet, if there's going to be any health for us to recover out of it, we really need to put it out there on the table, because we're going to need people to help us to get through it. You will not heal up from depression on your own. Impossible. It just can't be done. And the funny thing about, you know, it's like, you know those old Staples commercials where they had the red button?
Yep.
You know, it's like, and everything is better, you know? It's like, wow. You know, boy, did I wish we had one of those. Yeah, it was like, the thing is, when depression sets in, and it's, for me, it was really living a life without margin. I'll talk about that in a second. But it's just that everything starts shutting down. What happens is that your mind, and your mind says, it is too much stress, there's too much to handle, we're done. And your mind really shuts down. And that's why I was starting to feel dizzy, that's why I felt very confused, that's why I had a hard time making decisions. Just a whole host of things that were always just very clear for me became really unclear, and it's because my mind was saying, we've had enough, we're done. And so things just start shutting down, including your body. And it's just, because one of the things you'll see in depression is that you just want to sleep all the time. Actually, what happens is you want to sleep all during the day, and then you're awake all night. Oh, what a healthy way to live. You know, it's like, oh, wait a second. That's, reverse that, right? And so the And but this is what's happening to you in the midst of when you're in a really severe depression, is that, you know, things are changing that you don't want. And so everything is kind of shutting down, and there's no red button to push. And so you have to figure out, it's like, okay, how do I get out of this? By the way, I just want to recognize, you know, this is actually a pretty accurate for a lot of people that are in the midst of this. And you may have friends right now that are really suffering, or perhaps you're sitting here going, how I feel right now. That's okay. The pain grew and grew. I began to experience suicidal thoughts. I realized that life for me was at a desperate impasse. I thought of the garage as a place where I might sit in the car and inhale carbon monoxide. I looked at the rafters in the attic and think of them as places where I might hang myself. I looked at sharp objects as being implements for my wrist. And the thing is that because you're in such not only you are in physical pain, but you're in emotional pain, and you're just saying, I got to get out of this. And so you just start viewing things as a ways of getting out. For me, I kept thinking about, maybe I'll just walk in front of a truck. Hopefully it hit me hard enough. You know, I mean, it was just so dumb, you know, but yet, wow, I mean, it just kind of shows you, I was really feeling desperate, like, you know, in terms of, you know, where I was at. So, the next slide, actually I kind of already said this, but just put it up there, you know, what happens to us physically. Wow, that really messed that up. I don't spell that way. I would at least have put a hyphen there, you know, just like, even though that wouldn't have been in the right place. But anyways, on mine, it looks right, okay? So it's, again, physically, emotionally, spiritually, there's a lot of things happening to us because it's a whole body illness and it's involving every part of us. So what are signs of trouble is the next slide. Hopefully we won't have any disjointment here. So, margin, loss of margin. You know, we have a book here. Look, we have a Bible here. I love this book. Mm-hmm. I even read it once. just once. Yeah, you're thinking, oh boy. And we're listening to him. Yeah, I know. But UB has this problem all the time. They go, that's why they sent me here. You know, just like, but anyways, go to MCC, maybe you can help them. Yeah. And they're laughing the whole time I'm gone. But anyway, you know what makes a page readable? You think, well, the black ink, right? It's the white space. Of course, some of you have heard me speak on this before, so you already know the fill in the blanks here. But the thing is, what makes a page readable is that there's margin at the top, there's margin on the side, there's margin on the bottom. They actually put space between the lines. They put spaces between the words. They give you an extra space between words. That's better than the original Hebrew and Greek, by the way, where they didn't put any spaces between words. And no punctuation. That's why learning Hebrew and Greek is so much fun. I learned Hebrew and Greek. I know you should be impressed.
Wow.
Thank you. There you go. So anyways, but the thing is, but what makes the page readable, yeah, I'm always looking for compliments, and so I just have to put it out there. You know, yeah, it's like, yeah, it's a problem I have. I'm sorry. But I am really humble. I have to tell people that, you know, so that they know. You know, they know how humble I am. Yeah, you're thinking you should go back into another depression until you get this right. But anyways, but don't wish that on me, okay? So it's not nearly as fun as you think it is. But okay, I'm sorry, I'm distracting you. This is my, you know, I have problems. But the thing is, like I was talking before about, you know, when I was facing the opposition and I was facing, you know, just so many, I'm just hitting walls really hard. And instead of really finding space in my life to make sure that God was where he ought to be, I started working harder. In other words, I started living my life right at the top of the page, and I'm going straight all the way across. And I'm making the next line really close, and I'm going all the way across. And I'm living a harder and tighter life. And the thing is that God didn't design us to work that way. And so I was messing up. You know, as much as I love to just blame everything else, in my life and people that were involved in my life. I was just like, blame them for everything. The fact of the matter is, there was plenty of blame to go around, and I was a big part of it because I wasn't reacting to my own stressors correctly. So if you see someone or yourself, you see yourself living a life without margin in it, you know, that's a red flag. Same thing as withdrawal. Especially if you have someone like me who is outgoing and usually considered an extrovert and so forth, and all of a sudden they're not anymore, oh boy, red flag. Now, if you're a melancholy personality and you gas up by being alone, we're not likely to notice it as quickly. Okay? And so that's why if you're a melancholy personality and you're really a high introvert. By the way, we love introverts. Where would this world be without introverts? We actually need you. Yeah. Because we actually need somebody who's thoughtful. You know, it's just I'm not kidding on that. You know, I think out loud, and then if I hear it out loud, and then it doesn't sound right, well, it's already. But an introvert at least thinks before they speak. And so, you know, that's very handy. Do you want to say something?
I have no filters. None whatsoever.
Doesn't
exist.
Yeah, well, I've tried to learn to develop filters.
I have a very thin one that I try to get out when I'm at work.
Uh-huh.
And it works. Sometimes.
It works sometimes, yeah. Yeah. So I totally understand that. Totally understand it. But again, you know, withdrawal though is a sign that things aren't working well. Also, persistent sadness. If this is what was happening to me. Jess was not. Sadness is an emotion that God's given us. It's all right to be sad. There's lots of things to be sad about. But if it's not going away. And all of a sudden, everything is wrong. Well, that's a clue that there's things trouble. Indecision. My personality is very much a decision maker. You know, I would rather make a decision than not a decision. My wife, on the other hand, is just the opposite. She wants to have all the information in first. You know, and we balance each other out. It works out pretty good. Because she's not a decision maker, and then all of a sudden I could make decisions. Nothing was getting decided. You know, it was pretty crazy at that point. You know, I couldn't concentrate. I couldn't keep my mind on anything. Pretty well distracted. Had some really interesting anger. I'd get angry about things I'd never gotten angry about before, even to the point of rage. And I had never been like that before. That was just a totally new experience. At the same time, just at times, I'd also just weep unpredictably. Again, all signs of depression, that's not my signs. These are, you know, these will be lists that you'll find elsewhere as well. But they were pretty much true for me. I always tell, you know, when I didn't really hide it from the church once I finally came to agreement with the doctor that this was my problem, and so I told people, I said, don't tell me to snap out. So I say, don't tell a person to snap out of it, because if they could, they would, but they can't, so they won't. You know, so it's just really impossible to do that. So by the way, after I announced that in church in front of everyone, I still had people tell me to snap out of it. And I said, thank you for your loving care. And I was just like, oh, that was sarcasm, by the way. In case you missed that. So. But some people just don't get it, by the way. You just, and one of the hardest parts about that was that, again, one of the hard parts about being a pastor as well is that you don't. Not everybody in your church is at the same spiritual level, and I had people that accused me of faking it, like I really wanted to fake that. It's like, oh boy, I think I'll act depressed for 6 months. You know, it's just like, you know, and it was just really kind of incredible some of the things that people said, and I just had to be patient with it. I just had to, you know, what I really wanted to do was punch them in the face, but that wasn't any better than being depressed as a pastor. Oh, what's your pastor? Well, he's depressed and he punched me in the face. So I guess that just didn't tie in together. But it was hard to hear those things and be accused of such things, you know, and you're thinking, yeah, I've been with these people 7, 8, 9 years, and I love them. Even the ones that are driving me crazy, I love them. And then they turn around and say things like that. You know, it just was really hard. Again, that's why I say pray for your pastor. You often don't know that your pastor is receiving things like that. Because he's not going to announce that. You know, hey, somebody in the church congregation, I want to punch them in the face. So here's what to do. You have a loved one or a good friend that you feel like in trouble. Here's some advice I want to give you that you can transfer towards them, okay? I'm going to do the same list if it's true about you in a second, okay? But I'm going to do this list first. And the first thing I'm going to tell you is that come alongside them, okay? If you know someone's really kind of suffering and you kind of, the way they're just really hurting and they just are not out with anybody anymore and so forth, just come alongside and listen. Sometimes you don't really need to, a lot of times I'm not going to say anything anyway, but being there is actually pretty important. It was really interesting, when I was right in the real midst of it for the first, I'll say 4 months, I had one of the leaders in the church would call me about every other day to check in how I was doing. Now, this actually took a lot of guts on his part, because when he asked me how I was doing, you know what I would tell him?
Fine.
No. Mm-hmm. No, when you're depressed, you tell him exactly how you feel. Mm-hmm. There's no faking. You go, lousy. Now, how do you answer when people say, lousy? You're going, I was hoping for fine. Right? Yeah. You know, it's like, you really don't know how to answer that. But that they got that from me every day. I had another friend who called me every day. Every day he called me. And he didn't care what the answer was. How are you doing today, Paul? No, not so good. Sorry to hear that. I'm praying for you. No, thanks. See ya. Not long phone calls. But you know what? They were great phone calls. At first I was really annoyed with them, by the way. I was like, stop bothering me. You know, 4 months down the line, if they missed a day, I'd go, hey, they missed calling me. You know, what is the matter with them? You know, like, and it really became that. I had one friend who was really special about what he did. And the first time he called me and said, hey, Paul, I'm in the neighborhood. I'm going to get you a cup of coffee. And I said, no thanks. Don't come over. He goes, okay. And 5 minutes later, he rang the doorbell. Well, he really listened to what I said. And so he opens the door and says, well, I'd already bought the coffee. You know, so I don't know if that was true or not. He probably lied to me half the time. Anyway, they were good lies. But the thing is that the first time he did that, he just kind of handed me coffee, says, wanted to let you know I was thinking of you, praying for you, and here's a coffee for you. I went, oh, okay, thanks, you know, he went back to his car and drove away. But here's the thing. I remember, I'll never forget this moment. I said, okay, I drank the coffee, got it just like I like it. You know, we actually knew each other pretty well. And I took a sip out of that coffee and go, it really tasted good. That was good. It was Tim Hortons, but you know, I was just like, wasn't Starbucks, but it was still good. Yeah. Actually, I like Tim Hortons and Starbucks. But anyways, that's just gift cards are welcome. I don't know where that came from. Yeah, I don't, you know, it's again, I think out loud, and that was just a good example of that. A week later, he calls again. He says, I'm in the neighborhood, got a cup of coffee for you, I'm coming by. And I said, no, don't come. And he said, okay. I hung up the phone and he rang the doorbell. He was already at the door. He knew I was going to say no. He knew that. But he also knew what I needed. And that is just encouragement. And so this time, you know, I talked to him for a couple minutes at the door. I didn't let him in. I blocked. Because I'm, you know, I know I look like this, but I'm in shape, man. Round is a shape. So I used that really well and blocked. But he left. I tasted the coffee and said, wow, this is really good coffee. I feel a little better. And so the next, maybe another week or 2 weeks later, same thing. This time I let him in the door. We talk in the foyer for 10 minutes and off he goes. He never stayed long. Next time, 15 minutes in the living room. But you know what? He was life to me. Every time he asked to come, I said no. And he came anyway. Take that as a clue. If you really want to help someone, don't listen to them when they say no. Because they need you. And you're going to bring health into their life, whether they want it or not. You know? And those friends who called me and showed up with coffee, and there was others as well that came alongside, man, they were cool dudes and gals. I had one couple that was they were in the midst of a really bad situation in their marriage. She had had an affair, and just as I was just really in the midst of it, this guy is my neighbor. He actually lives across the street. And he goes to me, "You're the only one that can help." And I go, "I got nothing. I got nothing to offer." And he says, "I don't care. We need you. You have to help." And for 3 months, I had only one counseling situation that I took on. It was this couple, and God miraculously saved their marriage in spite of me helping them. It really was unbelievable. But I didn't have much to do. And so I just kind of concentrated all my efforts on that. And actually, God kind of gave that to me in the midst of that to say, "You still have purpose, Decker. You know, I know how you feel, but you still have purpose." And so it was interesting how the Lord gave that to me. Their marriage is going strong like crazy right now. It's unbelievable. It doesn't make any sense. It shouldn't be happening. But, From a secular standpoint, they should be divorced and messed up. And God brought healing into their lives, which is unbelievable. I always recommend get medical help. I did that. You know, obviously, I was going to the doctor. I did take medication to help me, and it did. It's kind of an art rather than a science. But the fact of the matter is that if you get into a deep depression, your hormonal stuff is off balance, and unless you're in a deep depression because you've got sin in your life, then you can take all the medicine in the world. That's not going to help that. You just got to straighten out your life, okay? And I'll talk to you for 15 minutes. I can figure that one out, you know. So, well, maybe 20. But anyway, see, the thing is that, but I really did have a physical ailment. And by the way, I still do. The different various glands in my body no longer produce the hormones like they used to, and so I'm still pretty much off balance all the time. And you're thinking, well, this explains a lot right now. Okay, I get that. But the fact is that sometimes there's a lot of, especially within the church, there's a lot of shame that's put on people who are on medication. I'm going to tell you right now, get that out of your head, because if your body's broken, you need help. And if medication is a way to help that, sure, let's go for that. I mean, I have a son who's a diabetic. He's a diabetic because his pancreas doesn't work anymore. You know, and so should I just tell him to buck up? Well, come on. Why do you have to be dependent on medicine? Okay, yeah, you're saying, well, that makes sense. Oh, you have a broken arm? Well, let God heal it for you. You know? Meanwhile, you're going around like this. You know, it's just like, and it's just like, come on, we're doing the same thing with people whose thyroid's not working correctly, or any of the other numerous glands that we've talked about. They're not producing the serotonin and those kinds of things that they used to do very normally. But now, because of a high level of stress, your body's just, your body said, it's not doing it anymore. And so this happens. And so if someone's on medication and you're saying, well, you're not, if you're thinking, well, you're not a very good Christian, come over here and I'll kick you in the butt, okay? Mm-hmm. It's just because it's, you know, it's usually a bit more complex than that, okay? So recommend to get medical help. Also, I say getting a counselor. I actually knew that I needed help. You know, it's like, and so I called up the counseling, the preeminent Christian counseling service in our area, because I was good friends with the guy that was in charge. And I said, Tim, I need help, and I know you have a very full schedule, but I want you. I was very demanding, you know. And he said, for you, Paul, I'll do it, which was great. And I needed him, and I knew it. And I needed someone who had insight on what it is to be a pastor, because I knew he had that, and the stresses that I was facing. And so, again, you know, it's humbling, by the way, to go to someone for help, to help you think straight, but boy, did I need it. And it was a humbling point for me, but I had always been the counselor, and now I needed counsel. And it was humbling, but boy, to this day, I'm really glad Tim was there for me, because I needed him. And he wasn't part of my church, and so it was like, he was a step away, you know, and so I didn't have any, there was no conflict of interest. I always point people to God, even if they don't want to hear it. You know, I'll say, because I always want you to understand that ultimately the solution is always the same. It's God. You know, I don't care what the other things are going on, and whether getting a counselor or medication, whatever. Those are all things that are going to be helpful, but still the final answer always is going to be God. I also recommend get rest, but get it the right way. If someone's having a bad sleeping pattern, you really got to encourage them to fight that. Okay? Because the easiest thing to do really is to fall into this stupid, I call it stupid because it is, to sleep during the day and then be awake during the night. And I was falling into that. I caught myself. And so what I would do is I would just deliberately stay awake during the day. I would allow myself a 1 hour nap. And I was kind of strict about that so that I would sleep at night. Now sometimes I ended up being awake for 24 hours. But in the end, I was really glad that I fought that, because that'll really mess you up to be functional in the world as a whole. Remember, there's no red button, okay? No red button. Medication, by the way, won't help you with that. There's some things you just really have to discipline yourself, because there's no red button to push. So you've got to use your brain, whatever's left of it at that point, you know, to go after these things. Hold on, let me keep going here. I also say, get exercise, and mostly I would say get fresh air. And there was at one point that I was like, I did not, you know, because I'm in shape, I didn't feel like I needed to get exercise. Quiet, I know what you're thinking. I was like, but anyways, but there was one time it was so bad, and I knew I needed to get outside. I knew I should do it, and it was really a cold day, and you know, so I got all bundled up. And I looked like this crazy little old man walking down the driveway. I'm like, and sadly, this is what it looked like. And I'm like, who's the little old man? Paul? He's not that old. Wow, he looks old, you know. And I was really shuffling. It was ridiculous. It was like, I don't know if you ever watched the Carol Burnett show and watched Tim Conway. But he always used to play this little old man. And that would be walking down the driveway. It was horrible. But I'll tell you, I walked down to the end of the driveway, I shuffled back, and I got inside, and I felt better. Yeah, all the people laughing at me, though, didn't make me feel better. But anyways, that was it. I also say encourage community. In other words, if someone's really going through a hard time, don't let them isolate themselves. Okay? Now, they can't take community in a big dose, but they need to get some doses. They can't just stay alone by themselves. They'll never get back to health by staying alone. Okay? So, now, I'm going to take that same list I don't know where we are. Okay, yeah. Do I have another? I think in this PowerPoint, I don't have another. Yeah, back off. Just leave it up. The other one up there. Yeah, good. So if it's happening to you, well, it's just we're going to reverse that and put it, you know, let people come alongside. Now, remember I did this wrong. I said, don't come. I was glad I had people in my life that ignored me, you know, and said, no, no, you need help. If it's happening to you, do not be afraid to go to your doctor. Sometimes depression sometimes happens because there are things going wrong in your body, and it can be solved medically. Now, that's usually a minority of the time, but it does happen. You know, so you can be suffering needlessly because you didn't get checked out by the doctor. So that's important. Find an appropriate counselor. Let someone into your life that actually can help. I don't want to talk to anybody. Well, shut up and let them come anyways. It's just like, well, you know what I mean. Don't be afraid to point yourself to God, realizing here's the answer. And I'll tell you that one of the, because I was older, I definitely have an advantage over when I was your age, because I've been around since the Civil War, apparently. That's one of my students told me at UB. And so this, but I've lived through a lot of conflicts. I've lived through a time where God has really, really done some really crazy things in my life that just have no other explanation except that God intervened and that God oversaw. It's just things that you say all the time, you go, wow, it's as if God was involved. Well, duh, yeah, he was. And the thing is, I kept going back to those and thinking, God has helped me before. I don't dare let myself not trust in him again. And so I just really did my best to stay with it, even though at first I just, those thoughts about suicide and all those kinds of things, that was only the first couple weeks that soon wiped away, which I was really thankful for. That would have been dreadful if it had continued. But I did the best I could to put myself in a position that I was staying as best I could connected to God. And I didn't pay attention to how I felt in that regard. So again, it's a discipline of the mind on that. But I had background on that, so that was a little bit easier for me because I had times I really could relate to. Getting rest at the appropriate times, really important. Getting the fresh air, again, these are things that you can tell yourself, I need to do this. And don't let yourself get isolated. I gotta be around people. I know I don't want to be around people, but I should be around people. And sometimes you just take doses of it. Sometimes I would just, at first, I would just, when I got back to speaking again, I still didn't want to be around people, but I could study, and I could give a sermon. And then when I was done with the sermon, I left. And I was like, oh, he's real friendly. Well, no, not really, not at this point. But anyways, eventually what I would do is I would just, what I didn't want to do is go to the door at the end of the church service and shake everybody's hand. Didn't want to do that at all. Just too much. I wasn't ready for that. But what I did do is I said, if you have any prayer needs, come down and see me and we'll pray together. And I could do that. And it ended up being a really effective ministry, so that by the time I really felt better, I never went back to the back door again. Mm-hmm. I just stayed up front and said, if you got any prayer needs, I'm right here. Because the ministry of the prayer became so, so powerful. It was interesting. There was some good that came out of that. Isn't that amazing? Mm-hmm. So now the next slide. What I did find is that there was a few verses that were really familiar that I grew up with and memorized 20,000 times because I've read the Bible once. And one of them was Proverbs 3, 5, and 6, which many of you have probably heard of, or if you've grown up in the church, you heard over and over again. But I'll tell you, these two verses came alive for me. Every day I would get up and I would quote these two verses. And you know why I quoted them? Because I felt like I couldn't trust God, so I said I had to. Mm-hmm. I said, I knew there was a truth there, and so I said, I'm going to hang my hat here that I can trust God in spite of how I feel. Mm-hmm. I'll tell you, sometimes getting up in the morning was trauma, by the way. I mean, it was just like, it would take almost a half an hour for me to just get out of bed. It usually started with throwing off the covers. Some of you might be able to relate to this. You're not even depressed, you know. And it's just like, you know, it's like, but I would stick one leg out, you know. And so I got no covers, I got one leg, and now I got another leg. You know, that was 5 minutes later, you know. Then I would sit up. And at that point when I sat up, that's when I would quote Proverbs 3, 5, and 6. Isn't that crazy? But it actually kind of worked. It was a routine that really helped me. I also took really long showers. That didn't hurt either. So, and I know, the only problem was that I was paying the water bill, you know, before. You know, it's like, if it's your parents' water bill, who cares? Okay, don't tell them I said that, okay? But anyways, there were some routines that really actually were helpful for me because it kind of gave me some sense of some regularity, so to speak. Anyways, Philippians 1:6, another great verse. I'm sure of this, that he who began a good work and you will bring it to completion the day of Jesus Christ. And you know, I came to realize that even though I was a big senior pastor, I was still an incomplete work that God was working on, and that I actually still really needed him, and I needed him a lot. It was really fascinating in that sense. Another, 1 Peter 5:7, cast all your anxiety on him because he cares for you. As I was coming out this verse, really, 6 months later, you know, I was really feeling this. That wow, you know, I kept this in front of the Lord, and I discovered they really did care for me. Obviously, I did come out of the depression, and it was about 6-7 months later. After about 2 months, I finally laughed again. So that the first month and a half was really pretty intense and dark, and nothing good was happening. And then I would get a good day and 6 bad ones. And then I'd have 2 good days and 5 bad ones. And then it was like every other day. And it just kind of slowly and slowly improved. And I became more functional, and I was able to do more things. And at one point, my wife, Dondra, said, my wife, she goes, "You're back." And that was like, that was really cool for both of us, because she recognized that that the old Paul that she married had reappeared. She did not know what to do with the new Paul. She was very frustrated by that. And she had to go get counseling because she didn't know what to do. Because her tendency was to say, snap out of it. Mm-hmm. And you know, she did come to realize that wasn't going to work. You know, so, and she very politely never said it, by the way. But I know she thought it. That's also because we had that discussion afterwards, and she confessed. And so, it's like, but by the way, I never held that against her because I, you know, it's because she was doing things right in spite of, you know, not at first, but eventually, you know, when she got some extra voices in her life, not crazy voices, like, but other voices that were speaking into her, that really helped her a lot. And so, I'll just end with this. And you're saying, oh, finally, thankfully, an end. At least that's what I would be saying. I did learn a lot in the process. I really did. I get to the end, I can't say that I'm really upset that it happened. I didn't want it to happen and so forth, but I actually learned a lot about God in the process. I learned a lot. I learned a lot about myself. I also learned, well, whether you believe it or not, it actually did humble me. You know, I'm just thinking, you don't look very humble. I know. I'm just going to tell you, I was really worse before. And so it's just a comparative thing. But the truth is, you know, I've gotten to the end, and I actually really feel like it was a blessing. That's just really nutty to say that. I still think, every time I have this thought, I think it's nutty. But I've gotten to the point where I really say, thank you, Lord, for the blessing of my depression. Now, I do add something to that. It goes like this. Please, don't send that blessing again. You know, it's just, I don't want to go through that again. I'm honest. I have no desire whatsoever. It was really, really hard. Other people have had harder things. I get that. You know, but the thing is that if you have a friend that's in it or you find yourself in it, I just want, you know, you are an instrument to bring hope into their life. And you don't have to know a lot. Just be present. You know, even if they don't want to talk, go watch a TV show with them, or take them to a movie, or, you know, do something, you know. If you have to drag them out of the house, you know, do it by the hair. Do whatever is necessary. Well, okay, not like that. But I think you get the idea, right? Yeah. You gotta move on it. So come alongside them. You don't have to be a professional, but you are an instrument of hope. And if you're feeling this way, let people in. Okay? If you're feeling like, oh, I'm just feeling hopeless, I can't take it, I hate school, I hate everything, I hate my family, I hate my friends, I hate school, I hate my friends, I hate my... Oh, wait a second, okay, that's kind of redundant. But anyways, this thing is let people in, because they're going to be helpful to you. Okay? Any questions really quick? Or not so quick? I don't want to shut anybody off. Or you just come and talk to me afterwards. Go ahead.
How did you get yourself out of bed?
I had this big anchor thing, and it was just being just very deliberate. You know, I went really slow every day, but I just, again, you just have to tell yourself the truth that you need to get out of bed, and no matter how hard or long it takes, you got to get out. And so you just, if it takes you half an hour, it takes you half an hour, but get out. And so, but it got easier as I developed some routines. I did some things the same every day, which started with saying a Bible verse. That it also included getting a cup of coffee, included taking a long hot shower, and that routine actually really helped me. You know, and so. So leaning into those kinds of things was helpful, but it was developing a routine. And I'm not really kind of a routine guy. I just, you know, I'll show you my schedule and you see, well, nothing's routine about this schedule. You know, and you'll understand that. But but I needed one at that point in time. You know, really, really helpful. Again, no red button, so you have to tell yourself these things. And then you have to act on them. Your mind is more powerful than you think, in both ways. It will lie to you. And by the way, also realize that Satan will use depression for his benefit, because he likes it when you're down. And he likes it when you're confused. And he likes it when you're paralyzed and in action. Also, these are all his favorite things. You know, and so when he gets believers paralyzed, this makes him really happy. So you have to kind of realize that. Good. Go ahead.
First of all, I want to say thank you for coming here.
You're welcome.
Humble person that you are.
Yeah, very humble. Very humble. I keep
telling
you that. I
always enjoy his Facebook posts because they are so funny. And I know that laughter is great medicine. Mm-hmm. What other medicine would you encourage us to take spiritually, like... for somebody who's maybe an introvert or an extrovert, is there an antidote that you would give them to help out a friend or encourage a friend for those different personality types?
You know, I don't think I really have anything specific except just presence. Not the gifts kind of presence, but just your presence. If they like gifts, bring them a gift, I know. Again, Tim Hortons and Starbucks and chocolate chip cookies are all my favorites. But if you know the person, there's something they like, you just want to encourage them and love them the best you can. But I still think that the presence was more important. I mean, I still laugh about the coffee guy. It wasn't the coffee. It was the fact that I said, don't come, and then he rings the doorbell. You know, that was really hilarious. You know, and I remember thinking, oh, he's so clever. You know, I don't want you here and you show up anyways, but I appreciated it. I wasn't going to tell them that. But I did.
You did one of these workshops at Infusion that mm-hmm. I attended, and it was very beneficial for me. And then recently they have something called First Aid for Mental Health
mm-hmm.
that they train the faculty with, the counselor does, for
Yeah,
we do that at UB too, yeah.
But
it would be a good thing. Maybe they could even come here and speak to us and first aid for mental health.
Yeah.
Just so that you know how to deal with people. And
yeah.
All these things are really great.
Yeah. One of the real surprises for me, though, was at the end. The joy that I had at the end was much different than the joy I had going in. And the joy I experience now is like 10 times greater than what I had before. You know, now, I don't like the method God used to get me there. I actually find it particularly annoying. But the crazy thing is that the joy I have now is rather irrepressible.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, it's I still get passionate about things. But, yeah, Lexi will tell you, because I got pretty passionate last week in Albany. But it's really been, but it's also been really interesting to me just to have a joy that that I can really share with other people. So, yeah.
Just out of show of hands, how many people have experienced, you don't have to answer this, we don't want to, of course, experienced somebody in their life with depression or depression themselves?
So it's a pretty pertinent subject.
Yeah.
And I grew up, you know, I kept thinking, this will never happen to me. Never happen to me. But my mother went through several really deep depressions. And so, fairly genetic in our family. And I just thought I was better than that. That was the pride part, just in case you think is there anything better in him? Yeah, there's one point. I thought I was better than that, and I turned out not to be. Stink, but it was a good lesson to learn. Okay, let me close with prayer. If you still have something you want to talk about or in private or whatever, just I'll hang around for at least 1 minute. Oh, gotta go. Sorry. Anyway, so okay, 2 minutes. Let's pray. Lord, thank you for our time together, and Lord, I do thank you that testimony of my own life of comforting me when I was in trouble, and just offering that comfort in so many different ways and helpful ways, and Lord, I thank you for that, that your concern and love for us is never ending, and Lord, I just pray that for those of us that are going through some hard times in this regard, Lord, I pray that, that our material today will be of help and we'll be able to apply them. And for those that need to come alongside others who are suffering, Lord, I just pray that you'll just continue to give them insight into their heart and their mind and how they might be of powerful help in their lives. And Lord, I just thank you that in spite of going through these kinds of things, that your love for us is just so overwhelming. And you have no desire to leave us alone, but rather just to keep calling us back to you. Lord, I just really rejoice in that truth today. Lord, thank you that you are a God that can be trusted, that we don't have to lean on our own understanding, which is pretty much a failure most of the time, but that you are worthy of every ounce of belief and faith and trust we send your way. And I pray that would just be really real and vital in this group. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.